Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
This is the day that God has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
And we know God is good all the time. We just, technology isn't. We're having some issues again. Hopefully, those of you that maybe saw it last week or went back to it afterwards, there was a clicking sound. And Jack pulled it up a few minutes ago, and there was a clicking sound. So we'll see if my camera does anything different. By the way, we're hoping the new system, video system that we will have that will be tied directly into the sound system will be in the next couple of weeks. So that will be a moot point at that point. Happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day.
And happy Father's Day to all the spiritual fathers, whether you have your own children or not. We thank God for the spiritual fathers that express their faith to those that are around them. God has gifted us that way. We have a birthday today. She's back there in the bell choir. I'm not going to say how old. Because my wife told me this morning, because it came up on Facebook, I guess. Yeah, it came up on Facebook. But it's Joyce Knappenberger's birthday today. So let's sing happy birthday to Joyce.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
Joyce, but are you joy-filled?
Oh, yeah.
We have some updates, some prayer updates. Gabriella Monte, who we've been praying for, who had COVID. She had the long-haul COVID. She is recovering quite well, and we received word that she also got married last month. So again, great news that we can report in our prayers. Also, Colleen Richardson had several successful procedures this week. Her back surgery, she went well, so we pray God for continued healing there. However, we also have new prayer requests that are not in the listing that we are going to pray for this morning. The brother-in-law of Susan Miles, who was our former secretary, had a stroke and is hospitalized, and the sister-in-law of Steve Curley. We will pray for, she is in late stage 4 lung cancer. And so we will include her in our prayers. Just want to remind you also that our seminarian has officially graduated. He has been placed in a congregation in California. And and growing up in Georgia, he's going out to California. But we said last year we've given him several gifts as we have sponsored him throughout his time at seminary. We want to give him a gift of a love offering for his graduation. We will be collecting that through next Sunday. So if you would like to give a special love offering to our seminary as he goes and becomes a pastor out in California, please bring that along with you next Sunday. Also, on July 4th, we will be having, as I announced last week, we will be having special worship, 8 hymns, both choirs, communion, and then a meal afterwards. It's our celebration of coming back together as the All Saints Lutheran Church family, and we really want to have a great festival day for us in our worship that day. Do you sometimes feel like the bulletin cover? That you're on dry dock. How fitting the weather coincides with the gospel lesson today. As the disciples and Jesus are out on a boat and a storm comes. What do you do? So as we prepare for that worship this day, as God has drawn us here together, we take some time in prayerful meditation. Let the Spirit guide your prayer. Use one of the hymn verses. As the Spirit shapes our hearts and minds for worship this day as the candles are being lit and the bell choir calls us to worship. Indeed, we put our trust in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the one who stills and calms the storms of our life. But he also takes that water and that wind, the breath of the Holy Spirit, as he pours that and blows upon us through the waters of our baptism as we begin in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
I invite the congregation to please stand for the singing of the hymn.
Come bring sun, endless is the
Today he tells you also, peace, be still. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, in your mercy, guide the course of this world so that your church may joyfully serve you in godly peace and quietness. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The congregation may be seated.
Thank you.
of Sunday after Pentecost is from Job chapter 38, verses 1 through 11. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, "Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Dressed for action like a man, I will question you, and you make it known to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who stretched the line upon it? Or on what basis were sunk? Or what laid its cornerstone? When the morning stars sang together, all the sons of God shouted for joy. Or who shut in the sea with the doors when it burst out from the womb? When I made clouds its garment, and thickness darkness its swaddling band, and prescribed limits for it, and set bars and doors, and said, thus far you shall come, and no further, and here you shall your proud waves be stayed." The epistle is from the second chapter of Corinthians, chapter 6, verses 1 through 13. "Working together with him, then, we appeal to you not to receive the grace of God in vain. For he says, in a favorable time I listened to you, and in a day of salvation I helped you. Behold, now is the favorable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. We put no obstacles in anyone's way, so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way, by great endurance, in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, the Holy Spirit, genuine love, by truthful speech, and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, through honor and dishonor, through slander and praise, we are treated as impostors, and yet are true, as unknown, and yet well known, as dying, and behold, we live as punished, and yet not killed, as sorrowful, yet always rejoicing, as poor, making many rich, as having nothing, yet possessing everything. We have spoken freely to you, Corinthians, our heart is wide open. You are not restricted by us, but you are restricted by your own affections. In return, I speak as to children. Widen your hearts also. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 4th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
On that day when evening had come, Jesus said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. And other boats were with him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat, so that the boat was already filling. But he was in the storm. He was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" And he awoke and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased and there was a great calm. He said to them, "Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great fear and said to one another, "Who then is this that even wind and sea obey him?" This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
The congregation may be seated. Grace, peace, and mercy from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. They say that was probably a Freudian slip. And Jesus was in the storm. It says stern, but I read it storm. I think that's really where the gospel is going today. I think that's what we need to hear in the moment today Yes, Jesus was in the stern, but especially as Bob read the Old Testament lesson, Jesus is in the storm. Have any of you experienced a frightening situation in your life? Have any of you experienced a frightening situation recently? I see my brother David Lang. Indeed, he and Barbara were in a frightening situation not too many months ago with COVID. But I want to ask you a couple of questions as we start this morning. What is more frightening? Before the storm is stilled or after it's been stilled? What's more frightening, when the world is out of whack or when the cosmos are under control? What is more frightening, when you're in the midst of a mystery or when the miracle has finally been realized? And before you go and answer the question that it's always A, that it's before the storm is still, it's when the world is out of whack, it's when the mystery is still around you, I want you to contemplate that the second answer, when this, after the storm has been stilled, when the cosmos are under control, and when the miracle has been realized, those can be frightening situations also. Indeed, miracles can be fearful things. How do I know? Look at the disciples. Were they fearful in the midst of the storm?
Yeah.
But when was it that they were filled with great fear? After the storm had been calmed. They were filled with great fear because they had just realized and were face to face with the awesomeness of God. That's what happens when a miracle is realized, is that we come face to face with the awesomeness of God. And oh yeah, by the way, the miracle also seems to demand one other thing. It seems to demand that we be changed. And I look out at a whole lot of people who love to be changed. Yeah. How often do we love to be drawn away from familiar territory? I love my routines. How about you? I love my regular patterns of life. Sometimes, yes, even taking a vacation knocks you out of that. Even though, like last Sunday or two Sundays before, when I didn't preach on a Sunday, it took me out of my regular patterns and I didn't know what to do, especially on Sunday morning. We love our regular patterns of life. But as we hear in this text, Jesus also calls to us and says, I want you to travel across to the other side. Some of you have been here for the 17, what am I at now? 17 years? Yeah, 17 years, I just finished. Some of you have been here for all 17 years. Some of you are just coming in now. But whether it was 17 years ago or whether it's today coming out of COVID and coming back together as a congregation, Jesus is calling us to travel across to the other side. He's asking us to go to a foreign land. And indeed, after this last year, aren't we in a strange time? Not just each one of us individually. We are in a very strange time as the church. By basically being separated and isolated, we've lost a sense of identity of who we are as All Saints Lutheran Church. And now as we come together, we are in this strange time of figuring out what that identity is. And we're going to realize that in this time, this strange time, we're going to experience that we have change. And some of the change is going to be from what we want. Some of the change is going to be from what we expect. We're going to find some differences. Things are going to be different than what we had planned for 3-4 years ago. Some of it's going to even be different from what we planned during the pandemic. Some of it's going to be different from even now what we anticipate. And when we begin to look at things, we begin to experience change, we know with change comes risk. And with risk, we find that it is inevitable. It appears inevitable. It appears inescapable. And quite often it seems unpredictable. So we want to be disciples at the start of Mark chapter 4. Sometimes, don't you just want to linger in the boat a little longer? As I saw some of you on the lakes this weekend, don't you just want to linger in the boat a little longer? Tied securely maybe to the dock, in the safety and comfort of the harbor. Just like the disciples, you want Jesus just as he is right now when things are good. Just as he was at the start of chapter 4. There they were. Jesus was in the boat. I just want to sit and listen. I just want to sit and listen to him preach all day long. I want to sit and listen and as he explains his teaching. Now, Jesus, don't go too deep on me. And don't provoke me, don't challenge me too hard. Just explain your teachings and then we can go out for lunch. And, oh yeah, maybe, by the way, you can grab a couple loaves and fish and feed all of us. And maybe you might offer a few therapeutics. Provide some remedies in my life that make me feel good. Jack, I'll do it. A boat is not made to stay in dry dock. That's not the purpose of a boat. And by the way, do you know what a boat symbolizes scripturally? Do you happen to know where you are sitting right now?
Nave.
You are sitting in the nave. From where we get our word, navy. The boat is the symbol of the church. A boat is not made to be in dry dock. A boat is made to go. And oh yeah, just as Jesus said, to go from one place to another. And whenever that boat goes, there will be a storm that materializes. yes, it could be a storm like this or what they're experiencing in Louisiana and Mississippi and Alabama and where the winds and causes destruction. But sometimes the storms are health conditions. Steve, your sister-in-law, and what your whole family is dealing with. And sometimes sometimes the storm that materializes isn't a heavy storm, but it's enough to uproot a few trees. But when the storm materializes, you find out that it disrupts life as you know it. Life as it is, and our life together. And in that disruption of life together, it creates within the community a place where you begin to question, you begin to wonder, you begin to feel angst. And you wonder, and you experience, and it reveals your fear. All Saints Lutheran Church is nothing but a bunch of old people. How can we be church? We're going to die out. We share distress. We also cry in despair. There are times when we speak just like the disciples. Do you not care? Teacher, do you not care? We fear abandonment. We fear being all alone. We fear that we don't have the resources to row the boat any longer. We experience the sea as it comes over and begins to fill the boat. And really the sense of that word there is not only that you fear the water swamping the boat, but you can feel the water beating against the boat, and you're afraid the boat is going to break apart on you. David and Barbara, as you shared with me during that time, I heard that's what you were experiencing. Not only being swamped, but having the waves beat against the boat. I watched my dad's funeral service yesterday. And even though it was 1995, I felt the waves flooding over the boat. Teacher, do you not care? But even though we fear abandonment, there is only one who has truly felt abandonment. As he was in the garden on that Thursday evening, and said, Father, there's just some other way. Take this cup of wrath from me. But not my will, but your will be done. As he hung upon the cross, nails driven through his hands and his feet. Looking down on those who are taunting him, he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." But coming to the point where he cries out in that distress, when he cries out in that despair that only he has felt and only he will feel, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And then he proclaimed, "It is finished," and bowed his head and gave up his spirit. But in 3 days, he did exactly what he did on the boat that day. In 3 days after his crucifixion, he did exactly what he did in the boat in Mark chapter 4. Jesus arose. Yeah, Mark says he awoke. But I don't think he just... he stood up. I think he stood up on the boat. And by the way, I have not been on a boat many times other than a big boat. But yeah, if you stand up in a canoe, you're taking chances. And those boats back in those days weren't very big. But I'll bet Jesus in that moment, on that boat, in the middle of the storm, he didn't just awaken. Jesus arose. Just as he did 3 days after his crucifixion. He arose and he overwhelmed creation. Not only did he overwhelm creation, he rebuked it, just like he did Satan. On the day of resurrection, he overwhelmed and rebuked Satan and said, "You no longer have any power." And he silenced the chaos. He silenced the chaos of the wind and the rain, and he silenced the chaos of Satan himself. Because Jesus acts with the authority of God. As he acted back then, as he acted in the resurrection, he still acts today with the authority of God. And through his actions, through his activity, he acknowledges the reign of God in our lives. The kingdom of God is here. We know because of his word, we know because of his body and blood. The kingdom of God is present with us today. It is awesome. And it can be frightening. And just with the disciples, so it does with us. It fills us with deep awe. And I don't know about you, but I know about me and I know about the Bible classes that I lead. It fills us with a whole lot of questions. But because of that deep awe and because of those questions, we get to see Jesus in our presence. And he transitions our fear and transforms it into faith. And in that moment, he opens our eyes. He opens our eyes to the new possibilities. Not only that we get to see him at work among us, but we also get to see the new possibilities of his work with us and through us. Where we now, All Saints Lutheran Church, as we stand here, sit here today in June of 2021, we enter a new future for our church. And he's going to extend us, yes, even a bunch of older adults, he's going to extend us beyond the limits of what we think is possible. Which means change. And change requires us to move. We're in a boat. Boats are made to move. Not backwards, but forwards. So change requires us to move from one place to another. Which means we're going to have to keep climbing into boats with Jesus. And yes, some storms are going to rise up. But that's where we get to see Jesus at work in our lives. That's where we get to see Jesus transitioning our fear and transforming it into faith. And then we are going to have that opportunity to share in his mission as we share in the ministry of the people in this place. And oh yeah, by the way, you've got a great place to sit. You got a front row seat right there in the boat with Jesus. A front row seat where you get to witness the redemption that he has done in our lives. But the redeeming of the lives of the people who are on the other side. And all God's people say.
Amen.
As we have received from our Lord, we also receive his gifts. That he has given to us. So let us join together in the singing of the offertory on page 192 of LSP. On page 5 of the bulletin, I invite the congregation to please stand. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us go to God in prayer for ourselves, for God's people around the world, and for all people in their various circumstances. For all people who are trying to commend themselves this day in spite of various afflictions, hardships, or calamities, that God would strengthen and guide first responders, medical personnel, and support agencies until health, prosperity, and calm are restored. Let us pray.
Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth.
For all people who are enduring beatings, imprisonments, or riots, that God would give wisdom to political officials, protection to military leaders, and guidance to authorities to work for peace, protection, and justice. Let us pray.
Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth.
For all who feel trapped by harsh labor, sleepless nights, or hunger, that God would surround them with caring people to provide the social, emotional, and physical relief they so desperately need. And for those near and dear to us, especially if we remember this day, Gabrielle, Colleen, Shelby, Donald, Grayson, Melanie, David, Clarice, the family of Adam, the family of Patricia, and for all others that we name in our minds and in our hearts at this time. That God would give them health, joy, and peace. Let us pray.
Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth.
Heavenly Father, we lift up our prayers for those who are traveling at this time, especially over the next several weeks, as we get ready for the celebrations of our country. We pray for the Richardsons and their travels, but we pray also for Andy and Chelsea as they leave for Greece on Friday. Heavenly Father, we also thank you for the fathers that you have given to us in our lives, those faithful men who have proclaimed the truth of Jesus Christ in our lives, who have helped us navigate the storms of our life that you have placed in our midst. And we just offer our prayers of thanksgiving that how you have used them. And that the church around the world would use the purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, and genuine love God provides to spread the news of forgiveness and salvation today and always. Let us pray.
Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth.
That we would realize both the power and the love of God seen in the person of Christ, our Lord. And that now, in this day of salvation, he would help us widen our hearts to be part of his answer to these petitions. Let us pray.
Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth.
Into your hands, Heavenly Father, we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The congregation may be seated. Countenance upon you and grant you his peace. Amen. Amen.